may have tested boundaries. I may have tested boundaries, is what he said, which is an astonishing thing for a male to say about relationships with teenage boys. But he said it, because I think he was confessing to what the true nature of his crimes were. He also said, when he was responding to the notion that Penn State had covered up his crimes, he said, quote, first of all, he said that was ridiculous. He said that Louis Freeh's theory was absurd. It was laughable. But he also said, first of all, there wasn't much to cover up. Now, if you take those two statements, I may have tested boundaries and there wasn't much to cover up, I think that tells you everything you need to understand about what really happened in this case. That all of this has been greatly exaggerated and blown out of proportion. Again, not to mitigate the crimes that Jerry likely did commit, but the reality of this situation is that they used war crimes. They used the worst, most horrific allegations to get people to stop thinking about this rationally, to think emotionally, and it created a crazed rush to judgment that created an enormous amount of damage to a lot of innocent people, including Joe Paterno, the three administrators who are awaiting trial, who aren't going to be able to get a fair trial because the jury pool has been polluted in that case because of the media and because of Penn State itself doing their darndest to try to plead guilty for crimes that they didn't commit. But I believe that those two statements are credible and actually explain what really did happen here. Now, I want to make it clear again. I believe Jerry Sandusky is a pedophile, but I believe that he was fighting his pedophilia. I believe that he was riding that line of plausible deniability. And I think it's very interesting that he only stopped getting away with pushing this line of plausible deniability, or in his words, testing boundaries, once his celebrity had faded, once he was no longer Jerry Sandusky, big time Penn State football coach, and now he was former coach. Oh, didn't he have something to do with that national championship way back in 1986? All of a sudden now, especially once there's a huge money incentive and everyone's creating this pressure and intimidation and investigators are trying to pull stories out of people and giving them these incentives to exaggerate, that it was then that all of a sudden all this caved in on Jerry Sandusky. He clearly had huge boundary issues. If you ask him, he'll tell you, well, that's because he grew up in a set of circumstances where everybody was naked all the time, and it was no big deal. I don't know that I buy that based upon the full totality of the evidence, but I think it might be closer to the truth than what we were told by the news media. So the bottom line of all of this, and I want to make this very, very clear, the reason why this matters is not just because I believe it's the truth, and the truth ought to matter. Unfortunately, it doesn't, especially in this case. But because it shows why Penn State did not and could not have covered this up. Because there was no evidence that Jerry Sandusky was the monster that we now believe him to be. And the worst part of this from Penn State's perspective is they're actually in a worse position now. Because it's only in retrospect that we think that this was a towering inferno fire they were dealing with, when in fact it was actually a small brush fire. And I believe strongly that Penn State actually thought, and actually probably was, treating Jerry Sandusky harshly based upon what they knew and what the reality was. That's the great irony of this. And that's why there's open emails about how to deal with this. And the emails can only be interpreted, I believe, through that prism. That they had no idea what we now believe Jerry Sandusky to be was even a possibility. Mostly because there was no evidence of it. And I believe there was no evidence of it because it wasn't the reality. And that's the only way I believe you can make all of this story make sense. Now, hopefully this video has made sense to you. I realize a lot of people are going to immediately think this is crazy. There's no way that John Ziegler could be the only person to say this. Folks, I'm not the only one that believes it. There are a lot of prominent people very close to this case, including, by the way, never admit this publicly. But the reality is there's a lot of very public, prominent people close to this case who believe exactly as I do. Some of them even believe more strongly than I do. There's a prominent author who thinks he's writing a book. He's asked me to be part of it. I've told him, well, I'll be part of it if I can say what I truly believe about Jerry, but he believes that Jerry Sandusky is completely innocent, as do many other people close to him believe that Jerry Sandusky is completely and totally innocent. One of the world's most renowned memory experts believes that Jerry Sandusky is totally innocent, but no one has the guts to say that publicly because the intimidation of this case by the media and by all these other forces, I believe, has caused the truth to be lost probably forever, especially since all the victims have been paid off by Penn State. This whole thing has been a travesty, and I'm just telling you what I believe because I believe I'm the only person in a position to say it. You can take it for what it's worth. I thank you for your time, and I hope that you'll continue to watch www.framingpaterno.com for further updates on this never-ending saga.